What a piece of junk.
Hi, we're back. MILLENNIUM FALCON, and we're now in issue 79 and issue 80. Let's go straight into issue 79. The H2 Executive Shuttle, which is a nice looking ship, but I have never seen it. But it's probably once again from the Clone Wars animated series. Nice design. Probably from the Senate, it looks like. All right. And Karlak, Frozen Outer Rim Worlds. Do not know it. Nope. Oh, we're going straight into the next part. So let's go straight into issue 80 then. Issue 80 opens up with the atmospheric assault lander, the ship we saw in the opening sequence of Force Awakens, the troop transport. More information about that ship from the Force Awakens. Elum, secret Jedi planet. Oh, they got their own planet now. Okay. And more shots from that. And the next parts, and this looks like it concludes the construction of one of the mandibles, top, bottom, and side sections, including some details, which maybe are be added later on. And we're starting working on the other mandible. Let's go look what we got inside the two issues. I've opened up both of them. What we got here is two boxes, and that is to support the mandibles. This is going on top. As you can see, like this. That's nice. Some hull plates, hull frames for the mandibles, lots of screws, and this thing over here, which is a white light, one of the headlights, the two of them, of course, one on each mandible. A quick word about these lights. In the model of the Orsini, we are being issued white lights and white LEDs for the front lights. These are screen accurate from Empire Strikes Back. However, in a few shots on Empire Strikes Back while landed on the Hoth base, one of the lights is white, the other is red. One can see that probably the white light is actually a green light. And in Force Awakens, I believe both front lights are red. Now, I've been looking in the possibility. Maybe both mandibles have two lights, one red, one white. It's not the case. So I will stick with the white lights. I will not make any modifications. Stick with the white lights on the front of the mandibles and continue working on that. So let's go straight in to constructing and finishing one of the mandibles and see how it looks added to the rest of the build. So it's time to test primers. As I said, last week I have two primers, which is one of these. This is the Motip plastic primer, which I use for my vinyl kits. And this is a very cheap gray primer, which I'm not quite sure if it will work on plastic, but there's only one way to find out. The advantage is that this more expensive primer is a transparent, so let's put it on this. And the other one is, as I said, a gray. But the gray one costs about €3, and the transparent costs about 15 to 16 euros. If the grey primer works, I might actually use that as a base coat. So, what we need to do is simply wait at least 24 hours to see how these primers react with the paint. Sorry, let me rephrase that. How these primers will react with the plastic and how they will react with the Tamiya paint. All we need to do now is wait. So we are now at issues 79 and issue 80. I've been looking over issues 79, 70, 80, and what we are supposed to do is finish the mandible we were creating in the previous episodes. And as I have mentioned in the previous episodes, there is a problem with those mandibles because I need to install, well, I can tell you all over again, but let's recap very fast now. So, this is part of the mandible. There are two of these mandibles. Hold on. There's an upper and a lower part of the mandibles. What we're supposed to do, or what we're supposed to do in the previous episode, was connect those two mandibles together. So we have one mandible, and now, what we're supposed to do now is put all the side panels on. The reason I have not done that yet is because we need to install these recesses, and in order to install these recesses, we need to somehow either find a way to mask these recesses, or stay off the recesses and first paint the hole. But we can't paint the hole yet because I haven't got the paint yet. There's no reason I have to sit still because there's something else I need to do or want to do. I have used the plastic primer and I've used the cheap primer, which I've told you yesterday. And here we have both the mandibles on the back side. This is the cheap plastic primer from the dollar store. This is a bit more expensive primer. What happened is this is very smooth. This is coarse. I also tried some brushing of paint over it. This has a The point is, paint stays on relatively okay on both. However, because this is a smooth, it feels plasticky. It doesn't feel like it's an actual ship's spaceship hull. Plus, I do not trust that cheap of primer. Anyway, so I'm going to go for the more expensive primer, however, and I probably need to buy another can of this, but that's for later. So I've already spray painted the top sides of the mandibles with the plastic primer, which is, as you can see, transparent. And before I can do anything, or before I want to do anything, I have also made myself a jar of not green, but appreciate, because I'm going to appreciate the Falcon's lines. I'm put a whole jar of this, and hopefully this will be enough for the entire Falcon. I hope, at least for the top side, as you can see. So that's the first thing I'm going to do. I'm going to appreciate this. Right, let's start working on the appreciates. And unfortunately, my very fine airbrush has just quit on me, so I need to use a little bit less finer airbrush, but I think it'll be okay. Let's try it out first. Let's see how thin the lines we can make. Not thin enough, unfortunately. Okay, let's start working on the first pre-shades. Now, for those of you who have never worked with pre-shades, the idea is that you use the airbrush and spray a very thin but distinct line of, in this case, dark gray with a little bit brown inserted, along all the points where the panel lines are. You will of course have some overspray, that's no problem. And when you finish with the pre-shades, you start adding layer upon layer of the actual hull color on, in this case, the Falcon. What happens is that the original black you have just painted on, or in this case the original dark gray, will slightly come through the color of the hull. And that slightly is just enough to convey some sort of a hint of shadow, hence the term pre-shade. Now, you don't use black for this. You use a dark gray, and in this case I'm using not a very dark gray, because the Falcon itself of course is light gray or almost whitish. So I'm adding a thin layer of, in this case it's a semi-dark gray, along all the points where a shade is required or wanted. All the recesses have been sprayed with a base coat. The circle ones are a bit darker than the others. What I've done also, a slight dry brush of metallic aluminum or aluminium, what's your preference. Now I'm going to splash all of them with water, plain just water. And the reason is I'm going to add a little bit of black, flat black, to that water as soon as everything is in. So a little bit of flat black. It's an extreme wash. Those familiar with the term wash, the black is going to mix with the water and is going to trickle into the lowest part of the model, or the details in this case. I have placed the Falcon on a turntable, or which is commonly referred to as a Lazy Susan, which is a wooden turntable which you usually use in the kitchen for stuff like that. I have used the bolts, the four bolts, so it stands on its four bolts. This is, as of course, the bottom side of the Falcon. And what I've done, well, as it can turn, I've done one half already. I have started the pre-shading. Normally I use a fine, very fine airbrush for this, but for this case, because it's the bottom side, I'm using one tip bigger. So this is the fine line, not the extra fine, but the fine line airbrush, because it's the underside, so it will create more shadows. As I mentioned earlier, I have created a jar of, in this case, pre-shade, which is a combination of black, but also some grays and a little bit of brown. So what I need to do now is just to spray. All the panel lines. And as you see, the lines are not very thin, but that's because this is the bottom side. The top side will be a lot thinner. What I've also done, and maybe you can see it, I have added small drops of that silly putty over here on these four corners, the same on the other side. Let's see if we can actually show it on the other side over here. And I have placed four drops, two over here and two, well, you just can't see it. That's of course where the LEDs were already installed, so these drops will prevent any kind of paint coming onto the LEDs. Making these figures for the Falcon is more difficult than I thought. I have made Chewie and I've been working on Han Solo. It looks bad at the moment, but that's temporarily, of course. First of all, I couldn't glue in the bottom leg. So I have here Chewie, hold on, Chewie, and I have had to cut off his underlegs, his legs and feet. Otherwise he wouldn't fit in his seat. I also had to, well, let me rephrase that a bit. The models are, as you can still see on the video, had separate arms and legs, and you had to glue them in place. However, it looks like the model was shaped to be a standing figure, not a sitting one. So to significantly change the size of the lower body to have the upper legs like this in a seating position. Fortunately, of course, Chewie is a hairy beast, so with some putty and some paint later on, I can mask all these strange cracks. A different story about Han Solo, which I have had seriously change. He looks like a very strange shoulder. His shoulder looks very strange. Once again, when you glue in all the separate elements of the arms and the lower arms, which is extremely difficult because the connection between those two is very small. It's maybe about 2 to 3 millimeters, and getting glue to stick on that is difficult. So what I do is I use a bit of rubber cement, glue it into place, and when it's relatively in place, add some drops of super glue and wait until it's dry, and then start to sand off the rubber cement again. As you can see over at his left shoulder, you can see there's a point sticking out which I have to sand down. As I was saying, the shape of the body looks like it's standing. It has to be standing down, and his arms have to be wide. So I had to change this drastically, and I did this on the other arm. As you can see, it's more now along his torso, but still it's in a right position. Although from the left side of it, to see it goes, it looks okay. The problem, of course, is it's transparent plastic, so every joint and every creak looks weird. I had to remove the driver's seat. That was because one of the arms of Solo fell out, and I had to remove the seat so I can actually get to that arm. It's a blessing in disguise because I still have C-3PO and Princess Leia, who have to sit in the back. My first idea was to have these figures loose so you can actually remove them if necessary. But considering they're not very sturdy, I'll probably glue them in place after I finish. So, as I said, blessing in disguise, because now I can actually build both Leia and C-3PO and fit them in these chairs to see if they have the right position. As soon as C-3PO has the right position and the right fixture, I can glue him in the seat behind Chewbacca, and then have this seat empty to build Leia. Step by step. It's a bit more difficult than I thought. It isn't nice to work. As I said, Chewie is the easiest because, first of all, his limbs are a bit bigger, so it's easier to glue his limbs into place. One small kink, however, is you can't identify the left and the right arm from the left and the right legs or lower legs, because his feet look a bit like, well, look at his left hand. It looks like a feet. It is his hand, but it looks very weird. But it's going to be hidden in the cockpit, and with some extra paint to mask the furs, I think it'll be okay. Now we're at the point where we can consider that these recesses are going to be installed pretty soon. I'm going to install these side panels now. Even though the instructions suggest that the recesses are already in place, along with some upper hole detailing, I'm going to go ahead with the side panels first, because I don't see any necessity in changing that order of build. Remember, a couple of weeks ago we had these screws in a bag which looked differently. I found out what they were. These are countersunk screws. These are actually the screws we need to install the side panels, and I will put them into a previously unused portion of the of my box of screws. Hold on, I have to open up the plastic a bit more. Okay, there we are. So at least they're separate from all other screws. Right, side panels. As I said, we have two halves of the mandible. I'm not quite sure which one this is. I believe this is the port side of the mandibles. However, so this entire construction will be done twice. So let's start with the first part. We have to use frame SF8, and once again, these are all stamped with an identification. This is 9, and this is 9. Actually, so there are two differences. You have these long ones and the shorter ones. The longer ones are the SF8 and the shorter ones are SF9. So we need one of these longer ones, and we are supposed to put it, let's see where they want us to put it, and most specifically how, like this. Okay, right, and the screws are going to go over there. Okay, okay. Now this system is also going to be used for the main hole, this system of side panels. However, there is a difference. In the original instructions, we will find that we need to glue on the detailed side panels later, just as we're going to do with the mandibles. That will mean, however, that you will never be able to open up the two halves of the mandible ever again, unless you break off all the detailed side panels. The same goes for the main hole. I'm going to change a few things on that, so I will be able later to open up the top and the bottom half of the hole. That is for the near future. And there's also going to have some other changes going to be done, but as for the near future. Okay, this one is in. That one actually pretty simple. And they want another SF8, I believe. Yes, another SF8 to go next to that. Okay. These screws are also lightly magnetic. Okay, and this going on over here. And I believe then the other three will go over here. There is no there's no side panel, side frame coming in the front. That is for later, because in the front we have a light, and that light is included in the De Rossini kit. But that will be installed later. Okay, I will continue installing all these side panels right now, and we'll be returning to you as soon as that is done. So this is how it's going to look like. It's going to look like a sandwich, right? All the side frames are in, except of course the front one, which I explained earlier, and the top section or the bottom, I'm not sure if this is the top or the bottom, is also in, but it's not screwed in yet, for reasons which I've explained several times now before, because we still have to install the recesses, and I can't install the recesses yet until I have placed at least one or two base coat layers of paint on the whole panels. Once again, I could install the recesses and then mask off the recesses using the silly putty trick, but I don't see the point of jeopardizing the fact that I do have some overspray, so no, I will not do that. Besides, and allow me to show you, let's see if I can show you, yes. Besides, I have learned that, I'm not quite sure if this is one of the recesses which is coming in over here, but that's beside the point. I've learned that the side panels of the recesses are the same color as the hole, so that means that I have to paint by hand all the recesses, at least the side panels, before I can install it in. So that's the reason why the top is not screwed in yet. I have to look at what I can do more, but I'm afraid there's nothing more I can do with this. We were officially in stage 79. And 80, yes, issue 80. I could do some minor fixing of these parts, but that will mean that I have to remove these parts from the screw, and I can't continue working on that until I have fixed both the upper and the lower part of the mandible. This is all detail work. This is where the front section comes in, and issue 80. What is to do with issue 80? Let's see. Is this issue 80? Yes. What do we do in issue 80? The only thing I can do in issue 80, as far as I can see, is start constructing the port manual.
Oh, this is the Star Wars. Okay. This is the Star Wars version. So this.
So now we're going to build the port manual, and we're going to start installing these. What's it called? These support jugs. That will mean that I will now really have to find a place to glue on the support jug or the support rig onto a plate or a piece of wood, because these have to be in position as well. That will finally give me a sturdy location to store the Falcon, also for transport if necessary. So I will need to do that as well, maybe tomorrow. I can work on the port manual as far as the instructions tell me, but we have to wait until next week until I can deal any further on what is now apparently is the starboard manual. Okay, the little figures are in, that is to say Leia and C-3PO. I know there is a big white blob on 3PO's head where his eye is supposed to go. I have to fix that. The most difficult of these figures, of course, is the tiny little connections between the arms and the upper arms and the lower arms, and well, you guess it is, that's very difficult. C-3PO was okay, Leia was a chore to get it in. And when Leia was finally finished, and let's see if we can actually see this, she didn't fit in the chair. So what happened is, she is now floating. Oh yeah, we can see it over here. Her arms are resting on the arms rest of the chair. And yeah, that's too bad. Let me see if I can get my arms still, that is. Okay, now all we need to do now is get Han Solo and Chewbacca in. They are currently drying from a bit of varnish, or matte varnish. And once again, I have to fix that eye of 3PO. Well, the figures are in. That was actually took me about 1.5 days to get those figures glued and painted. And never again. That was actually pretty difficult to do. So, why did I work on the figures? Well, actually, the answer to that is quite simple. The paint is not available yet. I was hoping this week I would be getting the XF55 paint, which I would need to mix with the white and a little bit of grey, but the paint hasn't arrived yet and probably won't in a couple of days, so I won't be able to continue on painting the hull of the Falcon, or at least the hull of the mandibles, before the end of this week. I will try to do as much as I can for the rest of this week, but that means that this is it for this week, unfortunately. Thank you for watching. Hopefully we'll be coming to the painting the hull next week, and we really catch up with the build of the Falcon, but it has to be for this. This has to be for it for now. Thank you for watching, and hopefully we'll see each other next week when we go on with doing something of with the lights of the corridor, because I just saw a video of someone else making those lights and he got a great idea. And I'm going to see if I can steal that plan, that idea. More on that next week. See you next week. Thank you for watching. Like, subscribe, please. And bye.